Organizations estimate that 28% of their cloud spend is wasted, yet only 22% have a mature cloud cost management strategy in place. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead at the Cube Research, and I cover AppDev. Mike joins me from Duckbill. Mike, how you doing?
Hey, good. Glad to hear. Doing well.
Yeah, great. Glad to have you on the show. Want to introduce yourself and introduce Duckbill?
Sure. Hi, I'm Mike Julian. I'm CEO and co-founder of Duckbill. We help companies build better cost management practices, negotiate their cloud contracts, and save some money on their cloud bills in the process. We've been doing this for like 6 years. A lot of our work actually predates the rise of FinOps, which has been interesting to watch.
Mike, I'm really excited to have you on the show because, as you said, the rise of FinOps, cloud cost management is really a topic that's top of mind. In my practice with AppDev, I focus on application modernization. Organizations are really continuing to accelerate the application development in the cloud in particular, and many are discovering that speeds and innovation often comes at the expense of that financial discipline. And when we look at, you know, what's happening with the rising cost of cloud investments, I stated there that 28% of cloud spend is wasted. Yet it really is crazy for me to understand that there's a critical gap of cost governance, right? When we look at 22% of organizations stating that they have only 22% stating that they have a mature cloud cost management strategy, it really does highlight the issue of how embedding cost accountability into AppDev workflows really is part of the how cloud finance is becoming reactive, siloed, and ultimately ineffective for a lot of organizations. I try to tell a lot of the C-levels that I talk to that when they start their modernization efforts, they really should take FinOps as front and center and not a backseat part of the equation. So to drive those long-term challenges and changes, organizations really do need to rethink how their engineering, finance, product teams, they're all sharing this cost of ownership around the outcomes right from the start of those projects. So Mike, bringing you back into the fold here, you know, there's a lot happening here in this space. There's a lot that's going on with cloud cost management, and many organizations, you know, go wrong trying to implement cloud cost, you know, management as part of their app dev flows, right, in their workflows. How do you reframe that approach? How would you recommend people to reframe that approach?
And I think that the stats you played were actually pretty interesting, but I think are actually probably worse. I think you said something like 28% is wasted, 22% was wasted. I think it's actually a lot higher than that, but not in a way that we think. So I think the biggest issue is that the biggest negative issue I ran into with our customers is they focus on the wrong things. They think like, well, I should turn off staging overnight, because that's wasting money. Yeah, maybe, but like how much? And every time that exact scenario has come up, the answer is pennies compared to the rest of the bill. And this happens all over the place. Anytime someone thinks like, wow, that one thing that is running, and then maybe I need to shut it down. Like it's often not really worth the squeeze. What we try to teach is that your true costs are actually how you've architected production. So how did you build the thing you built? Why did you build it that way? That's what's driving your cost. Shout out to my friends that run Kafka. Sorry, not sorry. You can see Kafka's bill from orbit just because of the way Kafka works. That sucks. There's a bunch of other stuff exactly like that, where because of how the architecture is built, you create these costs and you think of them as like, well, that's just the cost of doing business. What if it wasn't? What if that's not the cost of doing business? What if you re-architected even just a little bit, you could save vastly more money. So when I say that this 22-28% is wasted, but it's worse, I think it actually is much worse, because that gap is just a perceived gap between what we're currently spending and what we think we could be spending if we just turn some stuff off. What if you re-architected? What if you did more than turn stuff off? What if you rethought how you built what you have? That line is actually potentially much lower and, more importantly, a different shape.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you look at the numbers here, Mike, you know, it really does come down to what are we trying to identify here? You're right. I mean, if you look at, you know, that the technical resources or the tactical approaches, there's individual things. If you take a people, process, and technology around cloud cost management, that has a cost associated to each one of those pieces. And when you're talking about the spend here, that cost can be managed across the entire ecosystem. So, but when we start talking about these characteristics, the cost management for programs that not only reduce spend, but they also really drive towards that long-term accountability. That also means, to your point, Mike, is there's cultural changes that have to happen across engineering and finance teams. Would you agree to that? Because it sounds
absolutely.
Yeah, it sounds like that they have to really have a different mindset of what cost management means.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is really the rise of FinOps as a thing is supposed to drive that point home. It's sort of harkening back to the rise of DevOps. If you put developers and operations in the same room and say, like, look, this is all of your jobs now, rather than silos, then good things happen. And as it turns out, good things did happen. So what if we did that with DevSecOps? I'm still not sure that one actually played out to everyone's favor, but FinOps, that's what it's trying to do. I think it's still a bit early to say if it's really working or not, but here we are. So how are we driving that accountability? How as we as an industry of like adopting FinOps practices, how is that working? So far, I'd say it's a mixed bag. In my perspective, it's because of the cost being engineering driven. Engineering is making the decisions. Engineering is doing the one doing the architecting. Engineering is the only one that actually really truly drive lasting change. This is a bit of an issue for the rest of the company because finance, product, sales, everyone wants to have their say in like, could we save some money? Could we do this better? And no amount of finance wanting a thing is going to make that thing happen, which sucks for finance. But because engineering is being driven to ship features, not save money, this creates a bit of a tension within the company. So now we have finance teams who are hiring FinOps to try to save money on the bill, but it's not their problem. They didn't create the mess. They can't fix the mess. So now there's a lot of tension throughout the org. What do you do about it? And I think a lot of companies are finally hitting this point. It's like, oh crap, what now?
Yeah. No, you're spot on. I mean, think about it. When you mentioned DevOps teams, you mentioned AppDev, right? And when these organizations are tasked with a modernization project or anything that has to do with the CI/CD pipeline and the SDLC, they turn on resources and not worry about the financial impacts, right? So you have to balance this developer autonomy with the financial governance, right? And if you don't balance that, then you're going to have over-provisioning of resources, wasted resources, lots of costs kind of go into effect. Those challenges really kind of hyperinflate the project cost, to your point, Mike. And I think that there's a balance here that needs to be, talked about here. And I'll ask you the question, because we were on this topic. When we think about how effective organizations do balance this resource allocation and financial governance, how does this really work, especially when you're looking at the speed of key business drivers like AppDev? Because in our research, we're seeing that 24% of organizations want to release code on an hourly basis, yet only 8% are able to do so, right? And if the developers don't have that autonomy, how do they do their jobs effectively?
So the question, how do you balance these concerns? Why do you want to balance the concerns? I sort of challenge the notion that you should. And I say this as a company that is like, please buy our services to help us do this for you. Like, no. Like, we think about this as sort of a continuum. On one end, you have efficiency. On the other, you have innovation. And you can't do both at once. Innovation is expensive. It's wasteful. It's supposed to be. Efficiency is going to strangle innovation. So the closer you get to efficiency, the less innovation you're going to have. This is to be expected. Any company, any team, any given engineer can decide where they want to be at any point on this continuum. They can change. So what we'd say is pick where you want to be right now. We worked with a customer many years ago where they were overhauling a complete infrastructure. Like, yes, this is hideously expensive to do. And we're fine with that because we're innovating. We're creating something brand new no one's ever done before. So yeah, we're going to be wasting a lot of money. At some point, they dial that knob back and be like, okay, we know we have this thing running. It works. We know how it should behave. Let's improve it. Let's make it more efficient. And at some point in the future, they'll turn that dial back up again and go back to innovation. So I challenge the notion that you should, that every company, every team should want to balance the concerns at all times. I actually don't think that's true. I think that you should be intentional about where you are and why you are at that point.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. And I agree with that. Obviously, every company has its own focus and where they should be like looking at what they, how they want to deliver. I think one of the things I will bring up, though, is as we look at, you know, you're an expert in the space and cost management, cloud management, FinOps and such. When we look at this, what are some of the ineffective practices that we see with organizations, especially engineering-led organizations? What are some of those things that organizations or our viewers watching this, what should they be looking out for when it comes to, you know, some of these red flags that might come up on cost of inefficiencies?
I think one of the biggest ones is there are a lot of companies out there who reach for a tool for the first thing they do. And this happens no matter what the topic is, whether it's observability, whether it's security or CI/CD. Anytime someone thinks like, wow, I have this problem. Well, I'm going to go buy a tool because this tool promises to solve that problem. And it may or may not. But reaching for the tool before like truly understanding the problem, even exploring the space yourself a bit, is often a waste of effort. And particularly, you start solving it the way that whatever that tool you adopt wants to solve it, rather than like, how do we solve it in the way that makes sense for us? Is that method the appropriate method for our company? So reaching for a tool first is one of the biggest mistakes we see. That isn't to say you shouldn't have tools to help you. There are many great tools on the market for a variety of things. The second biggest one is focusing on the small wins rather than the big wins. So I talked earlier about focusing on architectural changes. Those are often the biggest wins you could possibly have, but they're also can be hard to come by. There may not be a lot of them, but there are diminishing returns in focusing on those small wins. So focus on the big wins first. The small wins will come later. The small wins are often the easiest ones and is why a lot of these things get like so much attention. Like, look how much money we save from turning stuff off. Like, yeah, that's great, but you can't do it again. Like, you're not going to have more stuff to turn off next month. You already did that. So focus on the big ones. And like, that's really where you're going to drive a lot of change.
Yeah, that makes sense. You know, actually, that aligns nicely to our recent research where we were asking organizations, 847 respondents indicated that out of those respondents, 75% said they use 6 to 15 different tools in order to look at their observability and their CI/CD pipeline and take actionable insights. 54% of those respondents indicated that they are in favor of a unified platform, reducing the complexity, reducing the number of things that they have to touch. And reaching for those new, like to your point, Mike, reaching for the new tools in order to drive something. They're like, hey, can we get something in the platform to move in that direction? You know, I think that's an important point to highlight because it's complexity and cost kind of go together. And then obviously skill gap is another big challenge that we see. But let's kind of talk about the application teams here, right? When we talk about the, you know, cost savings and the cost outcomes, what role should, we talked about the, you know, provisioning, right? The KPIs of the DevOps teams and AppDev teams is like push code out the door, right? What role should they play in the product and application teams? What should they play in shaping or owning those cost outcomes in your mind? Because, you know, again, they're hired to do a job and we hear everybody saying shift left, shift left, shift left. Everything goes to the developer. And there's only so much time with the developers in there with the catchers, you know, catching the ball. And they only have so much time in a day. How much time should be allocated to looking at cost optimization and cost outcomes?
I mean, you also got the question of how much time should any given developer think about security? There's no CISO on the planet that is going to say none. Every CISO is going to say more than they are, which is a great non-answer. But I would argue is probably the answer that we have for thinking about cost as well. Certainly not none, but probably more than you currently are. So more practically speaking, I'm a big fan of doing architectural reviews with the team, thinking about architectural plans just the same way we do with PRs. So if you go through an architecture, like here's what we're going to build, here's why we're thinking about building it this way, and here's how we think the cost is going to behave, and actually testing that out. So if you think that this is going to be driven on like 38 cents per transaction because of these reasons, that's great. Try that. Is that actually true? Is it actually behaving the way you think it is? I found that many teams are often surprised by the behavior of the cost. There can often be a lot of phantom costs in cloud, which often will drive more than the core costs, like data transfer being one of the big examples. So to me, shifting left in this case is also about do your planning and actually test your plans. Are they going to work the way you think they're going to work? And sometimes you're surprised.
Yeah, I like that answer. And the reason why I like that answer is it isn't just the it depends answer. It's the utilize the tools that you can use in order to do your job most effectively, but also understand the governance, compliance, and regulations that are in control for your business will help dictate what you're trying to do. And not to kind of put things in such guardrails where AppDev can only do so many things, but reality is they do need to. What would you leave the audience with a closing thought with regards to where they can go to get started? How can they figure out like what they need to do if they're just starting their journey, or even if they're mature in their journey? What would you recommend to the audience?
I find that a lot of people are trying to save money by going hiring all these tools. Go check AWS Cost Explorer. Just look at your bill. You will be surprised what you find in there. Just ask a bunch of questions. If you're interested in joining the community, there's the FinOps Foundation community. They're fantastic folks. Go hang out there. There's all sorts of conferences going on where there's just all this stuff, all these conversations are happening. So like, there's a lot going on. If you're interested in finding us, we're Duckbill. We also have our own community, our own Slack. Come hang out.
I think that's great. I mean, definitely being part of the community, being exposed to all the things that are out there, it's really the best way to educate yourself on how to know what's new in the environment. But Mike, thank you for being my guest today. This has been awesome. Your insights have really been impactful. I really think that there's a lot here to think about. And I also want to thank the audience for all of you that tuned in. It's been really great having you. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. But that wraps up this episode, and we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talents shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building an AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. Be sure to follow us on social. If you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach me at pauled@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.